Welcome back to Defenders Wise. Today I would like to talk a few minutes about Prophet Jeremiah. I want to share a few thoughts from the book of Jeremiah. Our generation does not take prophets seriously, but I think we can learn many valuable lessons from their lives and teachings. Abraham Heschel was a prominent Jewish theologian of the 20th century. He wrote many books focused on Old Testament prophets. Just the titles of his books evoke a great emotions in our hearts. One of his books is titled, God in Search of Man. He talks about divine pathos, the sorrow of God as he follows his people who abandoned him and rejected him. Heschel wrote, the prophets are some of the most disturbing people who have ever lived. As if the words gushed forth from the heart of God, seeking entrance to the heart and mind of man. Words from the heart of God, seeking entrance to the heart and mind of man. The prophets of the Bible have a lot of wisdom to offer to our generation. Even Greek philosophers borrowed from Old Testament prophets. When Lord Jesus was living in this world, a Jewish thinker lived in Alexandria. His name was Philo. We call him Philo of Alexandria. He claimed that Greek philosophers must have read the writings of biblical prophets. Christian apologist Justin Martyr also reported that the wisdom of Plato was borrowed from Moses and other prophets of Old Testament. If Socrates and Plato could learn from prophets, I am sure we can learn a lot from them. So let us read a few verses from Jeremiah chapter 1. The words of Jeremiah, the son of Hilkiah, of the priests that were in Anathoth, in the land of Benjamin, to whom the word of the Lord came in the days of Josiah, the king of Ammon, king of Judah, in the 13th year of his reign. It came also in the days of Jehoiakim, the son of Josiah, king of Judah, unto the end of 11th year of Zedekiah, the son of Josiah, king of Judah, unto the carrying away of Jerusalem captive in the 5th month. Then the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee, and before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee, and I ordained thee a prophet unto the nations. Then said I, ah, Lord God, behold, I cannot speak, for I am a child. But the Lord said unto me, say not, I am a child, for thou shalt go to all that I shall send thee, and whatsoever I command thee, thou shalt speak. Be not afraid of their faces, for I am with thee to deliver thee, saith the Lord. Then the Lord put forth his hand and touched my mouth, and the Lord said unto me, behold, I have put my words in thy mouth. Who was Jeremiah? He was born as a priest, but God called him to be a prophet. He was born in a small town, Anathoth, located 3 miles from Jerusalem. The Assyrian Empire came and terrorized the Levant for a while. Then a new empire came to prominence, the Babylonian Empire. King Nebuchadnezzar came and conquered Judah. Jeremiah was going to see terrible things: the fall of Jerusalem, the destruction of Solomon's temple, and the deportation of Jews into Babylon. He prophesied the kings of Judah. From the 13th year of King Josiah, that is 627 BC, to the fall of Jerusalem in 586 BC, from King Josiah to King Zedekiah, Jeremiah preached to five kings out of Judah. In chapters 1 and 2 of Jeremiah, God explains the sins of Judah. In chapters 3 and 4, he asks Judah to return. In chapter 7, we see Jeremiah going to temple in Jerusalem and preaching to the crowd. People were happy in temple worship and sacrifices. But Jeremiah gave them a rude awakening. He told them, "Your rituals and sacrifices do not satisfy God because your conduct is unethical." The law of God, you see, it demanded exclusive monotheism, but also ethical monotheism. You worship God alone and practice His laws in your life. Orthodoxy and orthopraxy. What you believe and how you behave. Israel failed in both respects. They joined foreign gods to their worship, and they failed in their conduct. In chapter 18, God sends Jeremiah to a potter's house. God asks, "O house of Israel, cannot I do with you as this potter? Behold, as the clay is in the potter's hand, so are ye in mine hand, O house of Israel." It's a powerful metaphor that shows God's relationship with Israel. He has been shaping this nation since its inception like a potter. But the land is full of false prophets who are giving a false sense of peace and perfection to people. But God told them their true condition. "For they have healed the heart of the daughter of my people slightly, saying, peace, peace, when there is no peace." That's from Jeremiah chapter 8. They interpreted the silence before the storm as peace and tranquility. People are not interested to listen to Jeremiah because they loved these false prophets. In chapter 20, we see one of these fraudulent teachers getting Jeremiah beaten, arrested, and incarcerated. Today we have archaeological evidence for the things mentioned in the book of Jeremiah. Irish archaeologist Robert McAllister went to the city of David, literally with a spade in one hand and a Bible in the other hand. He made excavations that unearthed many structures dating back to the time of Jeremiah and the fall of Jerusalem. Later excavations around the city of David in Jerusalem brought out more than 50 bulla with Hebrew names written on them. A bulla is a clay ceiling. On one of these bulla, archaeologist Egal Shiloh found a bulla with the inscription belonging to Gemaryahu ben Shaphan. Shaphan and his sons were mentioned in the book of Jeremiah in many places, like Jeremiah chapter 26, 24, 36, 10, chapter 40, verse 5, 43, verse 6. Shaphan was the scribe in the temple of Solomon. When the high priest Hilkiah discovers the scroll of the book of Moses, he gives it to scribe Shaphan, who opens it and reads it in the presence of King Josiah. Shaphan's sons were also active in the ministry. Jeremiah chapter 36 verse 10 reads, I quote, "Then read Baruch in the book the words of Jeremiah in the house of the Lord, in the chamber of Gemariah, the son of Shaphan the scribe, in the higher court, at the entry of Newgate of the Lord's house, in the ears of all the people." So this bulla with Shaphan's name on it was discovered in a home destroyed in 586 BC when Babylonians destroyed Jerusalem. Also consider another thing. In 2007, British Museum in London announced about a clay document dating from 595 BC. It describes a gift of 1.7 pounds of gold to a Babylonian temple by a chief eunuch named Nabushardushken. So Nabushardushken, the book of Jeremiah mentions the exact same official as Nebo-Sarsakim. Nebo-Sarsakim. He accompanied the Babylonian king Nebuchadnezzar when he marched against Jerusalem in 587 BC. I found it very interesting that an object from someone who traveled with Nebuchadnezzar was found. These amazing archaeological discoveries showing us the trustworthiness of the Bible as an accurate historical document. In 597 BC, the Babylonians invaded Jerusalem and confiscated sacred objects from the temple. They deported some leaders, deposed their king, and replaced him with a king of their own choice. The false teachers started resistance movement against the Babylonians. But Jeremiah wore a yoke. He wore a yoke like an ox. And he told the people, resistance is futile. Submit to Babylonians. But the people did not listen to Jeremiah. They resisted Babylonians. In 587 BC, Babylonians returned, besieged Jerusalem for 30 months, destroyed it, and took many Jews into exile. Jeremiah was forced to flee to Egypt. Jeremiah went to Egypt with some exiles. Then Babylon invaded Egypt in 568 BC, just as Jeremiah prophesied. Rabbinic history claims that Jeremiah was taken captive to Babylon. So Jeremiah's ministry that started in Judah continued in Egypt and later in Babylon. No matter where he was taken, Jeremiah was preaching the word of God. No matter what circumstances he found himself in, he was preaching the word of God. So you see, Jeremiah was living through a very distressing period in Jewish history. Israel was unfaithful to God. Throughout this book, God described his relationship with Israel in marital terms. He married Israel to be his faithful wife. They walked through wilderness for 40 years. Life was hard, but God took care of Israel like a caring husband. But after settling in the promised land, Israel became unfaithful to God. Israel, once a virgin, consecrated to God, now became a promiscuous wife. It went after foreign gods like Baal, Molech, and Ashtar. Why did Israel come to such a sordid state of affairs? God chose their patriarchs. He revealed his uniqueness to their forefathers. He saw their pain in Egypt. He sent them Moses to liberate them from Egypt. He did miracles during their exodus. He gave them the law. He led them for 40 years in the wilderness. He rained down manna on them, a daily miracle to feed them. He lived among them, first in the tabernacle and later in the temple Solomon built. He gave them a promised land that was so fertile and productive. He gave them festivals. He gave them offerings. He gave them kings. He gave them priests. He gave them prophets. Yet, they refused to obey God. They refused to honor him. They refused to worship him. They turned their hearts toward pagan gods and goddesses borrowed from neighboring cultures. Their hearts filled not with guilt but with ingratitude. They complained, God did not do much for us. How did they come to such an ungrateful condition? Jeremiah says, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? That's Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 9. The most deceitful thing in our world is our own hearts. Many times we blame everything in our world, our society, our politicians, our institutions, our economy, our education, and we fail to notice the pretensions of our own hearts. We are no different than Israelites around Jeremiah, folks. We enjoy many blessings from God, and then when a calamity hit us, we say, oh, this God thing did not help me much. On many Sundays, I should have gone for fishing instead of going to church to worship God. We say, I wasted a lot of time for God and got nothing in return. We fail to sing, when upon life's billows your tempest tossed, when you are discouraged, thinking all is lost, count your many blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord has done. Can you sing that song in your disappointment today? We feel like maybe it's time that I should try something other than God, something other than Jesus. We forget the faithfulness of God and turn to pagan ideas. Today we have so many Christians who believe in karma and reincarnation. Israel embraced pagan gods and pagan ideas. Kings of Judah had no gratitude towards God. They started to worship foreign gods introduced to them by their pretty wives. Recent excavations around the Temple Mount in Jerusalem revealed remains of Israelite houses dating back to the 8th and 7th centuries BC. Archaeologists found clay figurines in some of these homes. These clay figurines almost always portray a woman naked to the waist and cupping their breasts under their hands. So today we have archaeological evidence for the pagan practices carried out during the time of Jeremiah. It started with King Solomon. King Solomon, he built a magnificent temple in Jerusalem. He married many foreign ungodly wives. What they did, they turned his heart away from God, God Jehovah. This is the same man who wrote, favor is deceitful and beauty is in vain. What started with Solomon did not stop with Solomon. The kings of Judah and of Israel, almost all of them, followed that tradition, marrying a pagan wife. Soon Jerusalem and Samaria were filled with idolatry and pagan sacrifices. Many Christians do the same mistake in our time. For beauty, for love, for money, for ethnicity, for social status, for a job, or for simply getting married, they marry unbelievers. Soon they forget Lord Jesus Christ. Soon they stop going to church. Soon they stop reading the Bible. Kings of Judah and of Israel did the same mistake. They led people under their rulership towards idolatry and paganism. One person's negligence, sometimes it costs just his life, or sometimes just his family, sometimes just his community, sometimes even a whole nation. Last week I heard about a truck driver. This truck driver, he was driving his truck. He stopped by the roadside and drank a lot of alcohol. After a few hours, he lost his senses to intoxication and he drove that truck over people attending a roadside fair. 15 people were crushed under the tires of his truck and lost their lives. One man's intoxication made many orphans and widows in that neighborhood. Sometimes negligence could affect a whole city. Many years ago, a poisonous gas leaked out of a big pesticide factory in India, in a city called Bhopal. 16,000 people died in that incident caused by the negligence of a few factory workers and their managers. Sometimes negligence could affect a whole nation. Remember Chernobyl nuclear disaster. Before I write a prescription, I always check the allergies of the patient. Because if I prescribe penicillin to a patient who is allergic to penicillin, that might cost him his life. Our negligence will impact the lives of other people. The negligence of kings of Judah led their nation away from God to their spiritual death. They left God, but God did not leave them. He sent them a prophet named Jeremiah. Jeremiah, go and preach to my people. Go and warn the kings of Judah. They defile this land with idolatry, pagan sacrifices, sexual immorality, violence and injustice. If they do not seek forgiveness, if they do not repent of their sins, if they do not change their ways, I will punish them to the king of Babylon. Then God listed their sins. Let me read a few verses from Jeremiah chapter 7. For the children of Judah have done evil in my sight, saith the Lord. They have set their abominations in the house which is called by my name to pollute it. And they have built the high places of Topheth, which is in the valley of the son of Hinnom, to burn their sons and their daughters in the fire, which I commanded them not, neither came it into my heart. Therefore, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that it shall no more be called Topheth, not the valley of the son of Hinnom, but the valley of slaughter, for they shall bury in Topheth till there be no place. That's from Jeremiah chapter 7. They had temple of God on Mount Moriah. They did not think, oh, this is the temple of God. Let us leave it to Jehovah. Let us keep it sacred. We can do our pagan rituals somewhere else, away from the temple. They did not think like that. They were offering pagan sacrifices right in the temple consecrated for Jehovah. They built high places. They kept male prostitutes. They kept female prostitutes. Sexual immorality also became an offering to a god or a goddess. But unwanted pregnancies, unwanted babies started to irritate them. They came up with a wicked idea. Let us build altars in the valley of Ben Hinnom. Let us burn our sons and daughters on the altars. Our gods will be satisfied with the blood of our children, and we don't have to worry about how to raise these children. The God of the Bible created human beings in his very image, imago Dei. That is why human life is sacred. Human life is so precious and unique among all living things. That is why he prohibited all human sacrifices. He called Abraham to offer Isaac on Mount Moriah. But at the last moment, he stopped Abraham. He did not let Abraham to sacrifice his son. God was making a statement about himself. Abraham, unlike every god you saw before, unlike every god you worshipped before, I do not require human sacrifice. Almost all ancient religions practiced human sacrifice. Hinduism practiced human sacrifice even after the subcontinent came under British Empire. The Aztecs in Mesoamerica used to worship sun god. They would build altars to sun gods, and their victims were placed. They tear their chests, pluck out their hearts, and raise their hearts toward the sun. You know, at one point, Tenochtitlan, it was far more advanced than London or Paris. People were enjoying a very good quality of life. They were living in well-built cities, drinking bottled water. Tenochtitlan was rife with altars to sun god, sacrificing human beings. Tlaloc god was fond of boys and girls. They would offer sacrifices on their altars, and then they feed their cats with the hearts of sacrificial animals. But thank God, the gospel of Lord Jesus Christ went there as the light and put an end to the human sacrifices in Mesoamerica. Israelites were living like Aztecs 600 years before Christ. They were practicing human sacrifices. They made gods out of sun and other natural objects. They forgot their creator and started to worship creatures. Many years ago, I went to see one of my friends in India. He was worshipping sun god. I asked him, "Why are you worshipping sun?" He said, "You see, sun is the source of all blessings. We get light from sun. Without light, we cannot see. Without light, we cannot have plants. We cannot have food. Sun comes every day without failing. What is wrong with worshipping such an orderly object?" I saw a clock on his wall. I asked him, "Is this clock, is it working well?" He said, "It works fantastically." And I asked him, "The orderliness of a clock, does it reflect the greatness of the clock or the clockmaker who made the clock?" He said, "Clockmaker." I said, "The clock reflects the wisdom of the clockmaker. Doesn't the sun reflect the wisdom of the creator who made the sun?" Sadly, our society is committing the same mistake. It is worshipping the sun instead of God who made the sun. It is worshipping the earth instead of God who made the earth. It is worshipping the nature instead of God who made the nature. Israelites also committed the same mistake. They abandoned the Creator God who brought them into existence. They abandoned the Lord who brought them out of Egypt, who made them His chosen people, who sanctified them with His word. They started to worship nature instead of their Creator. God came down to rebuke them. Let me read from Jeremiah chapter 19. "They have built also the high places of Baal to burn their sons with fire for burnt offerings under Baal, which I commanded not, nor spake it, neither came it into my mind. Therefore, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that this place shall be no more called Topheth, not the valley of the son of Hinnom, but the valley of slaughter." The Israelites were offering their children to gods and goddesses. They made their own hands. They called it worship, but God called it slaughter. Many times we give names to things according to our own worldview. But God confronts us and tells us that those things, what they should be properly called. When I was a medical student and later as a resident, I used to order ultrasounds for our pregnant patients. Among many ultrasounds I observed, I still remember a few. I saw one fatal ultrasound in which I saw a fetus sucking its thumb. I saw a heart pumping blood. It's an image I can never forget. A fetus sucking its thumb. Today we have people who say, oh, a fetus should not be considered a human being. Sucking a thumb, is that not human? A heart beating, is that not human? A brain forming, is that not human? A face smiling, is that not human? God told Jeremiah, before I formed thee in the belly, I know thee. And before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee, and I ordained thee a prophet unto the nations. Before you were born, I knew you. Jeremiah, I ordained you as a prophet unto the nations. The sanctity of human life is a product of Judeo-Christian worldview. Naturalism cannot put any uniqueness on human life. Evolutionary psychologist Sarah Baffer Hardy did some research on langur monkeys in India. She found out these monkeys practice infanticide. Now, based on these findings among primates, Peter Singer, a professor of bioethics at Princeton University, now advocating infanticide for human beings. He argues, if monkeys, our relatives, can practice infanticide, why not us? That is where evolutionary naturalism ultimately leads us. Utter disregard for human life. We teach Darwinism to our children, and when they attack each other, when they kill each other, like monkeys, we wonder what's wrong with them. God told them their evils also. Let us turn to Jeremiah chapter 2. For my people have committed two evils. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters, and hewed them out cisterns, broken cisterns that can hold no water. First, they forsook God, and then they built cisterns, broken cisterns that can hold no water. Our society is no different today. It has adopted a naturalistic materialism as its thrusting worldview. This reductive materialism now came up with chemical activism as the solution for every problem under the sun. Recently, a young man walked into our clinic. He said, "Doctor, I want to hurt people around me. I want to hit people. Can you prescribe me some medication to make me less violent?" I was looking for the door just in case if he attacks me. "Can you prescribe me a medication to make me less violent?" That is the thinking that pervaded our generation. We want a pill to fix everything from words to violence. Anxiety? Try a benzodiazepine. Depression? Try an SSRI. Unhappy? Try marijuana. Fatigue? Try an amphetamine. Erotic? Take a birth control pill and engage in some relationship. This chemical activism, people are thinking about a pill for every problem. But God is saying, the first evil is forsaking God. God is the fountain of living water. God is the fountain of life. Today our communities have abandoned God, and we can see a culture of death descending on our neighborhoods. There is an opioid epidemic destroying thousands of young lives every year. There is a heroin epidemic enslaving millions of lives. There is pornography epidemic destroying millions of families and marriages. There is a suicide epidemic going on. Unprecedented number of college students committing suicides in our time. There is an STD epidemic going on. Millions of people are infected with sexually transmitted diseases. Then, in case if you miss, there is the physician assistant suicide. If you are tired of your life, we will make sure a doctor is ready to help you end your life. A culture of death reigning on our society. Millions of abortions that we don't have population even at replacement level. Many of our communities today will disappear soon unless they depend on immigrants and refugees. Our communities have such low demographics that soon Muslims outnumber Christians. Churches are being transformed into mosques in record numbers. Omar Mateen was a Muslim terrorist who described himself as Mujahideen, soldier of Allah. On June 12, 2016, he killed 49 people in a gay nightclub in the deadliest mass shooting in American history. He regularly prayed at the Islamic Center of Fort Pierce. This mosque is a converted church. The Muslims bought this church and converted it into a mosque in Fort Pierce, Florida. So you see, our churches are literally transforming into jihad preaching mosques right in front of our eyes. In the city of London, during last 1 year, over 500 churches were closed and 460 mosques are opened, and many of them former churches. The Israelites forsaken God, and the temple of Jehovah was transformed into a temple of Molech. We are seeing something similar happening in our time. Then God said the second evil was the Israelites hewed out cisterns, broken cisterns that can hold no water. Once we leave God, no matter how many cisterns we build for ourselves, they are not going to hold any water. Politicians, media, and academia, they have no solutions. We used to have a time when there was Christian right and Christian left. They used to exchange their ideas peacefully, respectfully, without using profanities. But today you see people like Bill Maher, people like Stephen Colbert, they resort to profanities to express their views. They can hardly complete a sentence without using an expletive. They remind me the words of Apostle Paul in Romans chapter 3. Their throat is open sepulchre, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. There is no fear of God before their eyes. It is the word of God that gives life. Under King Josiah, the high priest Hilkiah accidentally discovered the book of law. Josiah read the law, tore his clothes, and humbled himself in the presence of God and reformed his nation. Reformation comes only with the restoration of the word of God. The word became flesh and dwelt among us. Lord Jesus Christ is the physical manifestation of the word of God. May I ask you today to open your heart to Jesus and invite him into your life as your Lord and Savior. Thank you very much.
friends, our medical camp is coming up. We request you to make some donation towards this medical camp. Thank you very much. God bless you for your support.